Hello, I'd like to thank Leanne and Co for inviting me to contribute to this workshop, and I'd like to talk a little bit about how Madagascar's grassy highlands can be understood a little bit better using geomorphology and geology. And I apologize for the construction noise outside, which I can't get away from, unfortunately. So I rephrased Leanne's questions slightly for this talk, and I'm going to address each of them. So thinking about how geomorphology can contribute to the understanding of grassy biome evolution, what some of the key research questions are, where are the areas of uncertainty and disagreement, what kinds of limitations are there to understanding the Holocene evolution of the grassy highlands, and how important is cross-disciplinary engagement to understanding Malagasy landscapes in general, but in specific the grassy biomes. And so to start off with, geomorphology is fundamental to this discussion, in my opinion, because you can't understand the highlands without thinking about the erosional processes that have operated and how the landscape has evolved over Holocene time. And the grassy highlands are very interesting from a geologic and geomorphic perspective because they sit high, they are unusually high, and the slopes are quite steep. But despite that, they are not held up by bedrock, but by saprolite. And these saprolites can be tens of meters thick. And the saprolites, once exposed, have very little strength and erode extremely easily. And it is those characteristics of very thick saprolite that's almost cohesionless and its extreme friability that makes it vulnerable to this kind of erosion and facilitates the creation of lavas. Some areas of the highlands have lots of them. They are ubiquitous in the highlands, but they are not equally distributed. And there are many areas that have very few that appear topographically very similar and have very similar underlying geomorphology and geology. And although there is some indication that seismic activity and areas where there is more small-scale earthquake disturbance are more prone to lava formation, we have not yet really nailed down what it is that causes these things and how they are localized. But one thing that's important for this presentation is that lavas have a life cycle. They form on the landscape and they get larger and eventually they become inactive. And any part of the highlands landscape has multiple generations of these and sometimes they overlap with each other. And you can see here on the right is a younger lavac and on the left are very old, relaxed, completely inactive lavacs. And these would be on the left, stage five of the Wells and Driemahaj characterization of lavac evolution, and stage two or three on the right. So the key research questions in erosion of the highlands then are, you know, how do lavacs form? We still don't know this despite decades of research. And then what is the rate of new lavac generation? Like how quickly are new lavacs added to the landscape? And equally importantly, what is the rate at which they become inactive and are and cease to be important in the erosional budget? And there are numbers of areas of disagreement about this. There is a lack of agreement about the exact role that humans play in lavac development, whether their changes to the landscape were fundamental in setting it up for lavac formation, or whether lavacs have always been a part of the Malagasy landscape. The way in which lavacs interact with the landscape and that them as a component of the landscape trying to attain equilibrium. The timing of human landscape alteration, this is a very important one. There's so little archaeological information that people tend to extrapolate from the sites around Imern, where most of the archaeological data and the carbon dates come from, to other places such as, for example, Lac Alutra or other parts of the highlands from which there are no direct data. And then where is the balance between natural forcing in the environment and anthropogenic forcing? And undoubtedly both are important. The question is, what are the relative roles of each? And we now know that lavacs have been part of the Malagasy landscape for a very, very long time. And anytime you look at the margins of the remaining forests, as they get pushed back, you will find that preserved stage five inactive ancient lavacs are being revealed. And so here is a Google Earth area from north of Lac Alutre. And you can see the forested area on the right, and to the left is areas that have been progressively cleared. You can see right there the sort of the lollipop stick topography, valley head topography that is characteristic of Lavaux. And as you zoom in closer and closer, you can see that a lot of these valleys are definitely ancient Lavaux that were already there and probably healing on the landscape at the time that the forests came in and are preserved in the topography now that the forests are removed. The narrative, however, persists that human activities drove Lavaux development. And this is something that we don't still really have data to be able to either support or refute. And Christian Kull, a couple of decades ago now, stated that this narrative was based on errors, exaggerations, and unquestioned assumptions, and that actually remains true. But really, we don't know how humans affected the landscape because we still don't have the data with which to answer these questions directly. So things like, for example, long-term stream sediment gauge data, longitudinal analysis of Lavaux histories, sediment yield measurements from hill slopes, and dam infill measurements. There are some data for these things, but very, very small amounts and insufficient to answer the pressing questions about landscape evolution. A historical imagery analysis that my students and I carried out a few years ago of an area near Ambaton Drajac. So here we see in Google Earth view, Lac Alutra is up there at the top in the middle. And you can see the town of Ambaton Drajac in the center of the image, and a yellow box outlines our study area, which is about 376 square kilometers. And we tracked about 525 Lavaux using air photos and progressing to satellite imagery, starting in 1949 and going through to 2016. And we found a number of interesting things. First, and this might be one of the reasons that the narrative of human recency and their massive impact on the landscape is so pervasive, you go out and you look at things like these and they look like they formed yesterday or maybe just a few years ago. They're big, they're very fresh looking, they are scars on the landscape, but in fact these things have turned out to have been here for a long time. So if we look now at a couple of images, these two Lavaux, you can see the bottom right image is a Google Earth screenshot, and the Lavaux on the left there and the Lavaux on the right, you can see them here, the left and the right. And the same image, the same area in 1966 in an aerial photograph shown in the top left. The Lavaux on the left has increased slightly in size, so too has the Lavaux on the right, but both have remained remarkably stable. They are still generating sediment, but they have not grown aggressively or massively in that half century of time. Interestingly, in fact, this image here was taken in 2005. And when we look at that same Lavaux a decade later in Google Earth, we can see that it is stabilizing and becoming vegetated, which is quite interesting. But the point here is that a lot of these Lavaux that look like they might have formed rapidly and recently have in fact been on the landscape without changing a whole lot for considerable periods of time. So this is why it's important that we go back and we look at the aerial history imagery as far back as we can go and try and track what these Lavaux have been doing. This is a 1949 aerial photograph. This is to the east of Ambaton Drajac, and the large Lavaux, sort of the hook-shaped Lavaux system here, which is about a kilometer and a half in length, is the single largest Lavaux system in Madagascar, as far as I have been able to determine. Here it is in 1949, here it is in 1969, and here it is again in 2017 in Google Earth. And so again, you can see that these things are remarkably conserved. They're large, they can be quite fresh looking, but they have protracted histories. And in fact, again, if you look back at this series, there's a considerable sense that these Lavaux are beginning to fill in with vegetation and starting the process of becoming inactive. A couple of important numbers came out of the study. The first being that of 504 Lavaux that were active in 2016 in our study area, only 23 were new since 1949. So we can start to get at the addition rate from that. But just as importantly, 21 Lavaux that were active in 1949 had become inactive and fully vegetated by 2016. This is a fairly significant finding because it suggests that there may be a near equilibrium situation in the highlands where the addition of that, where the rates of addition and removal are close to the same. Obviously, one area of a few hundred square kilometers is not going to tell the story for the entire country, but it indicates that there is a story to be told and that data should be collected more broadly. Cross-disciplinary engagement in the quest to understand Malagasy biomes is crucial from my perspective, and geology and geomorphology can contribute to these discussions by considering the substrate where the grasses are growing and thinking about what's happening beneath those grasses and what the age and the history of the soils and the surfaces are. Natural stabilization is ongoing in these landscapes. And one of the interesting things, and it comes back to this idea of the narrative, the pervasiveness of the narrative of human interaction, human effects on the landscape, is that whereas people look a lot at the new erosional gullies, less attention is paid to the places where these lavaks are becoming inactive and reverting back to quiet, subdued landscape. The history of these highlands is geomorphologically very, very complicated. Undoubtedly, people are part of the story. You can't deforest a landscape and start farming it without doing something to the hydrology, to the sediment budget. But background processes need to be examined and understood, particularly in this geomorphologically very unstable landscape setting. And in terms of the biggest limitations to understanding Holocene grassy biomes, I think this existing mindsets tend to dominate the conversation and dominate the data collection questions that are asked. I think we need to pay a lot more attention to the natural processes so that we can decide and quantify the relative roles of human activities and natural processes and fully understand this system. Thank you very much.